No, I'm Susan Gould, and one of the core faculty for the Center for Bioethics and Social Sciences and Medicine. And I'm delighted to introduce the 2016 Ronald C. and Nancy V. Bishop Lecture in Bioethics. As you can read in your programs, the Bishop Lecture was established with a generous gift from the estate of Ronald C. and Nancy V. Bishop. Ron joined the UM Medical School faculty in 1951 and spent a career in research, teaching, and clinical care in the Internal Medicine Hematology Division and retired in 1987. He also served as director of the Unit for Human Values in Medicine for 3 years. And was a visiting scholar at the Hastings Center, which most of you probably know is one of the premier bioethics centers in the world. Both he and Nancy were strongly committed to social justice and service to the Ann Arbor and the Washtenaw County community. And several members of the Bishop family are here today. You can just raise your hand in a row. Yes, thank you for coming. And they have regularly supported this event with their presence and elsewise. So I would like to thank them for being here and for their support and for having such wonderful parents. And I'd also like to thank members of the Bishop Committee, who include Brian Zygmunt Fisher and Ray DeVries, the two co-directors, as well as Dr. Phil Margolis. Raise your hand, yes. And Dr. Chris Sawney, I haven't seen him here. And Reverend Ken Pfeiffer. I don't think he's here either. So for helping me every year to select and invite a bishop lecturer. I think Ron and Nancy would be especially pleased with both the speaker and the topic today. Dr. William Dale has devoted his career to the care of older adults with cancer. He completed both medical school and a doctorate in health policy at the University of Chicago, did his residency in internal medicine, where I also did my residency, by the way, and a fellowship in geriatrics at the University of Pittsburgh also. Now he's at University of Chicago, where he's an associate professor of medicine, section chief of geriatrics and palliative medicine, and has a secondary appointment in hematology oncology. Sorry, I'm using the acronym problem that was identified by one of our morning speakers. So in 2006, he established and now co-directs the Specialized Oncology Care and Research in the Elderly, otherwise known as SOCARE. And by the way, I love this because it's like, SOCARE. Sounds like a teenager says, SOCARE for my older relative with cancer at the University of Chicago. And SOCARE offers interdisciplinary, individualized, and integrated care and treatment for older cancer patients. He's an accomplished scholar. I'm not going to go into details about his publications, but they've had to do with decision-making, behavioral economics, and the role of emotions in decision-making in cancer. So I am very eager to hear his insights today on why do we so often overtreat, undertreat, and mistreat older adults with cancer. Please join me in welcoming William Dale.
Thanks, thank you. Thank you so much for that very kind introduction. It's always been a kind of goal of mine to come to the University of Michigan. I'm a Big Ten alum. Unfortunately, it's usually in the context of getting our brains beaten in by Michigan, since I'm an Illinois alum. But now Lovey's here, so we're going to be in better shape now. So I also want to thank the Bishop family for having me here to present. This group is a very intimidating one, as Angie Fagerlin knows, who was instrumental in helping me come here through the medical decision-making conference. So what I hope to do here is sort of do what I usually do, which is to be the least informed on about five different topics. There'll be somebody on each one in the room, but hopefully a little bit of insight from bringing them together in this kind of context. And I'm always a little bit either nervous or energized, so I'm gonna wander around a little bit as I talk. Hopefully you'll be able to hear me. Please wave your hand if you don't. So with that, let me get started. This was a great setup. probably done on purpose, but a couple of the earlier lectures were things I would have put into my talk had I had their slides in advance. So I'll be able to sort of use some of their information. So here's what I want to talk about. So I'm going to sort of show you as a geriatrician how I try to think about my older patients with cancer. One thing that often happens is I'm in an oncology clinic, and so patients show up and find out I'm not an oncologist, and there's that moment of recognition that I'm either, oh, good, you're not an oncologist, we can talk about other things, or, oh, where's my oncologist, I need to talk to that person. So this, for the record, is my oldest son. You can see this is the SoCare clinic. He was quite distraught that in oncology, I don't have my own placard or anything to announce what we do. And so he was in shop class and he made this for me. And you'll see later that now I've stuck it up in the clinic and they can't get it down. So it's there all the time for all the clinics. He's very happy about that. So here's my perspective. So as you heard, I'm trained as an internist, a geriatrician, and recently I did my board certification for palliative medicine. So that's my clinical background. And I'm embedded in oncology. So SoCare was designed with me sort of showing up in the oncology clinic, and they weren't sure why I was there for a while, but after a while it's sort of grown into a clinic. And at the end I'll talk about how we try to address some of the first part of the question with things we can do to make it better. Medical decision making has long been my goal. As section chief, I often see the administrative side of this too. So that's who I am. This perspective, you guys know who these people are? Yeah, so one of my favorite physician writers, Oliver Sacks, wrote a book called The Anthropologist from Mars. And do you know who this woman is up here? Temple Grandin. So Temple Grandin is the anthropologist from Mars. And she says, you know, the world needs different kinds of minds to work together. And I think that's fundamentally what we're going to have to do, is sort of bring different disciplines to cancer, geriatrics, palliative medicine, if we really want to take care of patients. It also describes my personal experience of being in oncology, given my background, which is often feeling like the anthropologist from geriatrics in oncology. And so my insights are more like that. I want you to think about not necessarily these two people, but the two people in your lives who are these people. So these are two older patients, both of whom got cancer when they were older, and both of whom had quite different outcomes as a consequence of that. And what I want to try to convince you of is the reason they had different outcomes has less to do with their cancer diagnosis and more to do with who they are. So in the personalized medicine sense, I know less about their genetics and more about them as people. And hopefully by the end we'll see why we need this multidisciplinary approach. And we'll revisit their cases and why they came out perhaps the way they did. Okay, so the geriatrician in the cancer center. So this slide changes a little bit depending on my audience, which is sort of why treating older adults is either really difficult or really challenging or really fun, depending on who you happen to be. This is what attracted me to geriatrics, but what makes it so challenging to take care of patients. So this is my ubiquitous graph of the population is getting older. There's more and more older people, and it's going to continue. And as you get older, there's more and more people with cancer. And the truth is that among adult patients with cancer, about 60% are over the age of 65. Being older with cancer is the norm. It's not the exception. So these principles are going to have pretty wide applicability. And the reason this is difficult is things we've heard about. Multimorbidity. They have lots of other conditions associated with being older, including cancer. They have other conditions that aren't diagnoses. They're not in necessarily a database that says you have all this list of diagnoses, but they have other things. You know, functional losses, there are cognitive issues that don't have a diagnosis, social circumstances that aren't incompletely captured. So the other issue is getting the evidence on which to base these conversations becomes quite difficult. So evidence-based medicine, when we have so little evidence, becomes one of the biggest barriers to figuring out what we're supposed to do. We can have very precise prognostic information for a cancer patient. Here's their mean survival. Here's the survival distributions. And then you say, how many people over the age of 75 were enrolled in that study? and it's diminishingly few, and how that information we have actually translates is often essentially unknown. And so if that's the case, we don't have an evidence base, we have to come up with some other evidence to base it on. We have lots of guidelines and quality metrics who suffer from this same problem many times, in part because the evidence on which the guidelines are based on are the same set of evidence that we just said we don't have the right patients enrolled in. And then there's the clinical pressures of us there in clinic trying to see a lot of patients in a short amount of time and applying a complicated set of problems. All right, I told you it's fun, not hard. All right, so here's the emphasis on evidence. When you look at these two versions of geriatric medicine textbooks, can you tell the difference besides the color of the covers? So between the third edition and the fourth edition, we sort of went to evidence-based medicine in between. At least even geriatrics decided to do evidence-based medicine. So that's what we do now. So the paradigm is, where do we get this evidence? Here's the enrollment in cancer trials. I talked about it a little bit, but to put some numbers to it. So the blue bars are the patients in the population of those ages who have cancer, okay? And then if you look at the yellow bars, those are the patients over those ages who enrolled in the clinical trials. So here's the population we're treating, and here's the population that's actually in the trials, and there's a big gap. Now you'd say, oh, it's not that bad. Those are patients that are hard to enroll in trials. There's another secret about who's in those trials. So these older patients in the trials, how do they look like compared to these patients out in the world? How do you get into a cancer clinical trial? Your performance status has to be 0 or 1 maybe. Those are the rock stars from geriatrics world. They're doing the best. They look like the young people. And you know what happens when we run the studies? They do just as well as the young people in large part. And what does that tell us about all those other patients who come in with comorbidities and limited life expectancies? We don't really know. And those are the patients that we have to come up with guidelines for. Okay, so this is my slide. I often joke, this is all my years of being a geriatrician. I boiled it down to these three ways of treating older patients. It's the title of my presentation. So we either overtreat them by making management choices. I've boiled it down to based on mortality alone. We look at a study, we see what the mortality outcomes are, and we say, because there's a mortality gain here, we have to treat you. End of story. And in many cases, there's so many things that are more important than a 3-month mortality gain for patients. We're essentially over-treating them. And I'm going to talk about how we do that and how we might avoid it. Oddly, you know, the same people, my under-treatment exam. So I'm always often on the phone, I'm talking to people about over-treatment, and I'll say, why are we doing XYZ? What's the evidence for this? And we have a discussion that fits right in with the choosing wisely guidelines, like stop doing whatever we're doing because it's probably not helping. Next day, same thing happens. I have a lovely patient. I'll show you her picture later. She was 103 when I met her. She managed to live another decade after I met her. Not because I'm a great doctor, trust me. She was going to live no matter what a doctor didn't. As long as somebody didn't do something, she was going to keep living. I was the perfect doctor for her for that. So, but she showed up she fell down, she broke her hip, and she was in the emergency room at 105 with a broken hip. And they called me and said, she's here, she's 105. What do you want us to do? And I said, well, what would you do with a 70-year-old person who came in with a broken hip and a lot of pain, who's ambulatory? Well, of course, we'd pin their hip. I said, you just answered your own question. Please pin her hip. And they said, she's 105. And it's very hard to get away from sort of this age-based way of thinking about patients, which I want to convince people is not the right way to think about people. So they did pin her hip, and she lived to 112, as it turned out. So I don't think that was a bad decision. She remained ambulatory for most of that time. And then mistreating is, I have some examples, and I had to take one out, but I'm happy to talk about in the question and answer period because it wasn't a cancer example. We have all the evidence. We know what it is. We know what we're supposed to do. Even when we're just supposed to talk about it, as we heard earlier, we might not do that, much less do something about it, and we just do the wrong thing. We just do the wrong thing. I don't know why, but I'm going to make some guesses about why it is, and that's why I'm going to talk about emotions a little bit towards the end, where emotional things come in, and we are unable, even in the face of having all the evidence, of doing the right thing. And older people sort of get this more than others as patients, in my opinion. All right, I just read this book. Has anybody read this book yet? I highly recommend it. Paul Kalanithi wrote this book, When Breath Becomes Air. For those who don't know, he was a neurosurgery resident very near the end of his training, 36 years old, and he's diagnosed with lung cancer out of the blue. And he dies a year later and writes this book as sort of what it was like to go from being a doctor to a patient. Now, he's obviously not older, but this quote comes up in the book, which is full of these kind of quotes, which is, my relationship to statistics changed when I became one. And I think that transition for people where we have evidence in the statistics, especially evidence-based medicine, which is statistical, and then we have that patient sitting there right in front of us, and the emotions they're going through, the emotions we're going through, just overwhelm that statistical calculation. And the truth is, you know, my 105-year-old with a broken hip, there's no statistics for that. Nobody knows what to do from the studies on that. So sometimes we have to come up with sort of N of one thinking that I want to sort of talk about a little bit. Okay. So, all right, I'm going to try to present a little bit of data now. That's my sort of, I hope you're interested in the topic part of the talk. I hope this sort of is makes you want to know a little bit more. Is there anything about that that's either unclear or you're ready to, hopefully, yes?
So you had Overtreat, Undertreat, Mistreat. Is there ever just quality treat?
You know, I knew someone would ask. You know, I think there's a way to do this, right? I forgot to do my, you know, I'm at the University of Chicago. So do you guys know who this is? This is my University of Chicago slide. That's Odysseus. He's sailing between Scylla and Charybdis, right between overtreatment and undertreatment if you're a geriatrician. So, you know, this is what I think we're always trying to do. We're trying to balance between, are we overtreating this person, are we undertreating this person, and then avoid these biases of mistreatment. So I think we can do it. It's really hard. And one of my messages is going to be, it takes some time to do this. And we're being pressured to do things with zero time and not a lot of patient interaction. And I'm worried about that being, you know, penny wise and pound foolish, and especially for these populations. So I hope so. Hopefully by the end, you'll feel a little bit heartened that we have some answers. So overtreatment, you guys can see I liked people in pictures. Who is this guy? He's quoted in the New York Times a few years ago. Any idea? His name is Paul Applin. He invented PSA. So the New York Times tracked him down when PSA became a problem. And here's the paper he wrote on PSA. He just wanted to find a better biomarker for prostate cancer in 1970. And this is his quote. I forgot the first quote. Screening men with PSA has become a hugely expensive public health disaster. Never what he intended, never what he thought PSA was going to be used for, sort of shocked by it. It's the classic overtreatment story, right? So we have a marker, we start using it in ways that aren't intended. Here's the classic PLCO study. So this is the big study with 77,000 people in the United States. There's a European study equivalent showing that basically when we screen with prostate cancer, at least do annual screening, we find more of it. And if we keep following those people in general screening programs and look for mortality gains, we don't get them. We never find them. Whatever we do when we find the extra cases of cancer isn't the right thing, or screening just isn't useful in that setting. And that's the main finding. You can screen, but you can't save people's lives. The European study found something slightly different. There may be some disease-specific gains that can be made, but the number needed to treat, even in that setting, the number needed to treat to save one life from prostate cancer is what? Does anybody know? It's a high number. It's over 1,300 per life saved, even in a setting where we can statistically show it saves some lives. So it's unlikely that screening with PSA is very helpful for most people, and it's the classic overtreatment case. So these were the conclusions. I did want to point out it's another example where we've applied the data like widely now. Anybody sort of precepting residents these days on prostate cancer screening? Do you know what they're taught? What are they taught? Don't do it. Don't ever, ever draw a PSA from anybody for any reason is more or less what my residents think. And I think it's an example of how we're not even thinking about screening in any reasonable context anymore, about when it might be useful, when the prior probabilities start to go up, when 10-year life expectancies are long exceeded, and that may be a case where we're now going to be under-treating. I want to make a case here that isn't the main theme. Guess who we're going to start under-treating for prostate cancer? Young black men with long life expectancies are going to have more metastatic cancer soon. Because they're going to get prostate cancer, they're going to get a bad kind of it, and they're going to live long enough to experience the downsides. And they're one of the cases we know who actually have higher prior probabilities. So I'm worried about that. And we'll look a little bit at this, but this sort of ham-handedness about how we think about patients is really going to hurt us with older patients more than others. The caveats of this, you know, in that study, that PLCO study, you know how many people in the control arm got screening? Half. Why was that? We let them do whatever they wanted in the control arm. Only 85% of those in the treatment arm got screened because 15% of them just didn't, for whatever reason. Study was stopped early because they saw the effects they did. It was a negative study. It was underpowered. I just point that out in that even in this study that we're basing so many of our guidelines on, we have underpowered study with strong recommendation not to screen. It's unusual, and I think there's been sort of a lack of attention to the data in some cases. So here's what's happened. We did these studies. Now we've put out guidelines for screening for prostate cancer. This is our study. Others have done the same sort of thing. This is after the case. What we have along the bottom is your 9-year mortality based on our best sort of geriatrics model of life expectancy, which goes from low to high. And this is for a 75-year-old and their PSA screening rates in 2 years, 2005 and 2010. That's what the two color bars are. Now, what really strikes you about this, right? So these bars should be what? There should be a whole lot of screening at one end, and there should be almost no screening at the other end, right? And there's sort of a bump above 50% and then a drop down to a little above 35%. Even with these strong guidelines that my residents are coming from, at least so far, we haven't seen any of this. And the guidelines that came out that originally said for over 75, there should be no PSA screening happen between 2005 and 2010. So the question is, here's a case where we have evidence that people believe, we've putting in these guidelines, and it's had very little impact on what's happening. That's the sort of mistreat part. Even after all the work, time, money, energy people have put into getting data, we still don't really follow the data, even when we think we know it. And the worst thing is, gosh, I wish they would stratify some. It wasn't just sort of almost a coin flip no matter what. So we must be doing something else. So here's another one. So these are men with prostate cancer who have either low grade or high grade disease, and it just takes all comers on leading causes of death. So if you have prostate cancer and you have high grade prostate cancer, what's the most likely thing you're going to die from? Prostate cancer. Knowing that you have high grade prostate cancer is a good thing for knowing what to do for your care. That's who we want to find when we screen, is those out of those 200,000 people that have prostate cancer, 30,000 a year are going to die from it. Second leading cause of cancer death for men is prostate cancer. The problem is we can't find those 30,000 in the 200,000 very well, even though we have a really good way to find them. Biopsies are really, really good. They're very specific for prostate cancer. That's the right follow-up to a screening test. It's not a bad way to do it, but so that would be good to know. What's the leading cause of death for those with low-grade prostate cancer? Cardiovascular disease. What's the second leading cause of death, which would be a great board's question? Some other cancer. Not prostate cancer, some other cancer. So what does that mean for the prostate cancer care for someone who has low-grade prostate cancer? they should be getting colonoscopies, right? They should be getting screened for their other cancers, which we sort of dismiss sometimes. They say, you have cancer, we're not going to do stuff. And I talked yesterday with people looking at what should we be doing for prevention for cancer patients. Prostate cancer patients probably need just pretty much the same screening as anybody else if they have low-grade disease. So this just sort of gives you a hint about how easy it is to over and undertreat if you're not thinking about the data in a smart way. Okay, so that's my overtreatment. Every one of you in your own disease has great examples. I gave you mine because I know prostate cancer, but every disease has this examples where we're overtreating because we have data in a certain area, we decide we have to treat it, it makes us nervous for people to have that and not do something about it, and we overtreat. And the Choosing Wisely campaign has been all over this. So we could come back, there's other examples, but I want to keep moving it for the big theme and move to undertreatment, which is often not addressed for older patients. How often we undertreat older people? All right, sorry for all the prostate cancer examples. I study prostate cancer. It's the easier one for me to explain, but they translate. Here's an interesting example where they actually sort of did the right thing. They went and looked at patients, they got a fair number of them, and they controlled for things that we think probably matter, including comorbidity scores, how bad the cancer was, what the PSA was, how experienced the doctor was, and even their remaining life expectancy. Someone comes in, low-grade prostate cancer, we assess their life expectancy, and then we see how often they get the definitive therapy of choice for most men, which is surgery. And guess what the likelihood is of your getting surgery, at least in this data, if you're over the age of 70? Almost zero. Really, zero? That can't quite be right. There must be some men in that group who are perfectly reasonable people to get surgery, but they're just not. Why not? I don't know, but probably just because their age went above some number that somebody decided makes them a non-eligible for surgery. So we have to come up with other ways to decide on fitness than age, and this is sort of an example of that in my mind. Here's another one. This is pancreas cancer treatments. We've been working on pancreas cancer patients. So this is, you take all comers with pancreas cancer. For those who do or don't know, it has a very bad prognosis. If you find it early, surgery is the only potential cure. Without surgery, life expectancy is pretty poor, even with current treatments, less than a year in most cases, 6 months in a lot of others. So surgery is really your only chance for cure. Most people, if they have localized disease, these are only localized pancreas cancer patients. So they were all, at least in theory, on paper, eligible for surgery, which would be the only curative treatment. So of the 9,500 who were eligible with stage one cancer, 27% actually got surgery. If you look over here, for the reasons that no surgery was offered, 40%, it just says, not offered surgery. That's why they didn't get surgery. No one even asked them whether that's what they want to get. There's another of other groups that seem more reasonable, 10% for advanced age. Again, that's a questionable thing. Comorbidity seems more reasonable, that's 6%. Here's 4% where the patient refused. So I doubt that of that 60-some percent, with 4% who refused, that the rest also refused, and that's why they were turned down. So this looks like we just decided not to, for whatever reason, if you're above a certain age, again, we're not going to do this surgery. It's a big surgery, I admit it. We're trying to figure out how to stratify patients better. But I'll point out this patient of ours, this is Mr. Snare. He had pancreas cancer. He was 90 when he got pancreas cancer. And he's a tough old vet. Came in, wanted to get surgery. And my colleague Kevin said, we'll do it. Sent him to my clinic, we assessed him. He had surgery, he lived 5 years after 90, lived to 95. After surgery. I love this picture because if you can see the bottle here, he's not sure if Kevin, my colleague, saved his life with surgery or the honey he took every day saved his life. Whichever it was, he lived 5 more years. And the bottom is a patient of mine, a longstanding patient of mine who got, not pancreas, but she got ovarian cancer presented. I found her with, I felt terrible. She had metastatic ovarian cancer after I'd been taking care of her for years. There's no reason to have screened her. I can't think of anything I actually missed in the whole thing. But same thing, got called with what do you want to do with her? And she was a like, do everything. She's perfectly fit on no medicines. She was 89 years old. This is her after she got surgery, full dose chemotherapy, swimming at the YMCA after she recovered from her surgery. It's not that I'm so smart that these people will do well. They are the rock stars. These are the top 5% in those age groups. They're gonna do well more often than not. So we just need to identify them. She didn't like me putting this picture of her with her bathing suit, although she consented to it. She said, who wants to see me in my bathing suit at 91? I think she looks lovely in her bathing suit and convinced her otherwise. Okay, so that's under treatment. There's lots of examples of that. People who are older, who are fit, who are not even being offered therapies because they're too old. And it happens a lot, and we need to figure out how to identify those patients. So mistreatment, here's an example of mistreatment from the literature. So here is a great study. Anthony D'Amico is a wonderful researcher. These are men who the study, so it's a clinical trial. Clinical trial is you have prostate cancer, you're either gonna get radiation therapy alone, or you're gonna get radiation therapy plus hormonal therapy. And the primary study results published in JAMA show that adding hormone therapy to radiation therapy improves your life expectancy, right? That's the curves. The higher curve is the one getting the hormones. In the same data set published in a smaller place that's often unknown, Dr. D'Amico published another study, and he stratified these groups in a slightly different way. All he did was say people with more than one comorbidity in one group and people with one or less comorbidity in the second group. And guess what happens? The survival curves flip. It's actually more dangerous to give the hormone therapy to those people with more comorbidities than those without. But if I talk to my radiation oncology colleagues, and I do all the time, we argue incessantly about giving hormone therapy to a perfectly good treatment, which is radiation therapy. Now, it's a reasonable argument to have, but I bet we don't have it most of the time over whether to add the hormone therapy because the data says that you're supposed to give hormones with radiation now. And I'll talk later about why giving hormones to older men is quite dangerous. There's probably a reason even something simple like a comorbidity stratification picks out people who, for whom hormone therapy is not a good idea, okay? So this is where we have the data's known, we can show it to each other, and we still don't do the right thing. And that's an example of mistreatment. Here's the slide I would have swapped out about site of death and where people want to die. We heard a little bit about this earlier. So patients, you know, tend to die, as you'll see, in the hospital or in a nursing home, and patients want to die at home. And why is it that we get this wrong? Maybe insurance is one of the reasons that this happens. I suspect there's other reasons that we have a difficult time identifying those who are getting closer to death. I suspect we have a hard time talking to people about when they get closer to the time that they're gonna die, and that it's an example of where we just, it's more a behavioral economics issue about when we make these decisions as much as it is sort of trying to have people die in the hospital, which nobody really wants. So that's another example of mistreatment. Okay, those are just snippets of data. If you were gonna want a lot more, there's lots where that came from. What I wanna shift to, so that's what we do. We're gonna shift to this question earlier was, is there a better way to do this? Is there a way to sort of avoid these three traps? Is there a way to be Odysseus and sort of sail nicely through, you know, past the whirlpool and past the monsters? And this is sort of putting the answer right up front. This is what I try to do in my clinic. This is how I address the questions. This is how I try to bring data that does exist, but not necessarily in oncology, to the table. So first one is estimating life expectancy. This is actually proves to be fairly hard, but if a lot of our decisions are, how long are you gonna live? If I treat you for this cancer, how long do you have to live for us to think you'll benefit, even in mortality terms, from that? And I'm going to argue that something like geriatrics can actually give us some answers about life expectancy that is not often brought to bear. And they're simple tools, they can be used. I'm going to argue we can do that. Once we know life expectancy, then we can do what I call stage the aging while we're staging the cancer. So to put in context, the treat the cancer as aggressively as we can and minimize the toxicities. Timelines is another thing I want to say. It's one thing for me to say to put a patient through surgery or start them on chemotherapy, but when do all the side effects happen for things? Right away. They die from surgery. They get toxicities from chemotherapy. That all happens right up front. Where do all the benefits happen? Where do the survival curves separate? 2 years, 5 years down the road. So those things matter. So even if I'm deciding it's because of mortality reasons I'm doing it, there's still a lot of considerations about how do we get there. Again, Kevin Rogan would tell me when he came to me about pancreas cancer, he said, look, on average, I give people 6 more months if I do surgery on these older adults. 6 more months. That's the statistical average of gain. And you know how long it takes them to recover from this Whipple procedure I do for them? 6 months, basically. And then they sort of get back to baseline, and I took away 6 good months. They were pretty good when we started, and I gave them 6 months right at the end. Was that the right trade-off? Did I do the right thing for these people? I need you to help me decide if I'm doing the right thing for my patients. Those are the kind of trade-offs I think are much more realistic for older patients, not whether they're going to live 3 more months on this treatment versus no treatment. And then decision-making and communications, how do we do these conversations? How do we frame them? We heard a very eloquent discussion of this. What are the emotions involved? What about trust? How do we actually communicate even when we know what to do? Okay, so now I'm going to sort of talk through some of these potential solutions to the problem, and then I'll be delighted to hear other suggestions. Oh, this is Miss Darden. She broke her hip at 105. This is her. She dressed like this to come to clinic too, which I love. So she would always come in. She eventually, at the very end, started losing her memory. So she's a very formal woman who had been an assistant principal at the first African-American high school in Chicago. She came from Texas. And she would say, the caregiver would say, hey, it's Dr. Dale. He's here to see you. She'd go, I do not know this young man. But I'm very pleased to meet you, Dr. Dale. Very formal. This is her 112th birthday party. So she would invite us to her birthday party. I took my sons. She loved to drink wine and cheese every day, basically. And so this is her with her glass of champagne, me sharing it with her. I have lots of good stories about Miss Darden. So here's age and life expectancy. I'm sure many of you have seen this, but I think it's still the best guide to this. Louise Walter and Ken Kavinsky put this out and just went to the life tables and said, look, age can't be the thing that we're using to stratify people. It has to be something else. So these are age-based distributions for the median survival. So at the upper end, those are the healthiest quarter of the population at that age. This is the less healthy part of the population. This is the median. So when we're sitting there to give some prognostic information, it's important whether if you're 70 years old, you're in the upper quartile and you're going to live almost 20 years. If you're in the lower quartile, you're going to live less than 7 years. When I decide what we're going to do when you have to live 10 to benefit at all from some screening procedure, I'm just not even going to talk about it. It's just not relevant to your care. It's not a priority. On the other hand, cancer screening is very relevant for that healthy group. And other things like that 80-year-old who's in the upper quartile is still at about 10 years of life expectancy. 10 years, it's a lot. It's a lot of time to live with whatever we're going to do, and it's way more than that 70-year-old in the lowest quartile. So if I wanted a number to stratify people, life expectancy is way better than age. And just those are some of the things I want to point out. Even at 85, you're talking about 8 more years. So why is it when you're 70 and I think you're going to live 12 years, and then you get to, so that's 82, right? Then you get to 80, and you're in the middle group, and now you're going to live to 87. And so then I get to 85, and now you're going to live to 90. What's going on? Why are those people in the middle keep living longer and longer and longer? What's that? It's like the old residency rule, right? The longer you stay, the longer you stay, for those who've been along long enough. So this is the equivalent. You know, who dies in that first cohort? These less healthy people are dying. In a very weird way, the longer you live, the healthier you get. You're in this healthier cohort. It's why we're so bad when people get older at realizing how healthy they are. And that's why we undertreat those people. So keep that in mind. And it's important to know when you're having these discussions with people. All right, here we are. I picked some random people from the population. So which one of them are frail? Which one of them are vulnerable, we call, and which one of them are healthy? They're all approximately the same age, at least when I imagine this picture. So here's HF at 70. He's in good health. His life expectancy is about 18 years, as long as he stays away from small planes and maybe lightsabers. So that's one 70-year-old. Here's another one, lived a harder lifestyle. He's 76. His health status I'd call fair, and his life expectancy is more like 9 years. And here's another patient, 72, poor health status, has had an LVAD placed, I think, now. His life expectancy is, I'm sorry. Oh, he did have a transplant, and his life expectancy is 4 years. I tell the joke, independent of political affiliations, you know, despite the 4 years, you know, like in the movies, he keeps coming back, right? <Yeah. laughs> So maybe he's a statistical outlier. Okay, so the real question is, it's great to know life expectancy, but are we any good at this? Are doctors any good at estimating life expectancy, even in a statistical sense? And that's a real question. I'm going to argue we're better than we do worse than we could, that we have some ideas about how to do this. Here's some things that are interesting to me. So if you ask doctors to estimate life expectancy, we heard about this earlier, are we any good at it? So if you take doctors, patient comes in, we ask them to estimate life expectancy, we go in the back room, we say, okay, we're not going to tell the patient, tell us how long you think they're going to live. And what do? Overestimate. We overestimate. The better we like the patient, the worse we overestimate it most of the time. So we're not even very good at that, because the so-called eyeball test that we use, just looking at someone and deciding, isn't that good. We're not that good at it. Guess what happens when we walk into the room with the patient, if we talk to them at all? We add some time on top of that overestimate and make an even worse overestimate when we talk to the patient. So that's one warning for we need some data so that we can go in and talk to them with data. Here's the thing about patients. Do they want to know what we think? Do they want us to prognosticate? They kind of do. I get it all the time. If those who practice, like, what's my time? What's my prognosis? I really do. Most patients say they want to know. Here's the thing. So now you're going to go in. You're going to do the right thing. You're going to talk to them. You're going to tell them prognosis. You're going to try your best to not be biased. And what are they going to think? They don't like it. If you're really accurate, they actually don't like it very much. And I think it's why we don't do it. It's very hard to have that conversation with someone. Because we don't fundamentally know, we only know statistical distributions. So it is really hard. I still am on the side of the earlier speaker. I think we have to find a way to communicate effectively to patients about what their realistic life expectancies are, because they can't make these decisions about reasonable therapies unless we use this. I just don't think it's appropriate. So can we do it? Here's an example from something we've done and others done. This is just taking some very simple geriatric assessment measures. Not a long battery, just some real simple ones. One is just using comorbidities. This is in the cancer screening context. One is health, self-rated health. One is the timed up and go test. Have someone stand up, walk back, time them, see how long it takes. And there's some standards for people who do better and worse that target life expectancy. And then functional health. So that's things like IADLs. Can they do things in their daily life? And this is for cancer screening. Look at those curves. Maybe not so much for comorbidities, but what about their self-rated health curves for whether they're in the best quartile or the lowest quartile? Looks a lot better than that earlier thing we saw where we saw the cancer screening statistics, right? This is actually a much, much, much better. It's not perfect, but it's a lot better than it was when we started. Functional health's probably better. That information's available, easy. Will give us a much better guess about who's in the better or worse life expectancy categories to make treatment decisions. So I would argue for this. Self-rated health's an amazing predictor, by the way. If you want to know anything about patients, have them tell you their own assessment. So can we use these geriatric assessments for cancer care? I just want to walk through some of the examples. One of the objections I get to it is, this is too hard, it takes too much time, we got to see 1,000 patients, we're never going to do this in clinic. And I want to argue that It's not that hard. For goodness sake, they do bone marrow biopsies and CT scans that take way more time and cost way more than anything I'm going to show you. And this is as valuable in many cases and lots easier. So here's one. This is just questions you can ask somebody. There is an age stratification. After all, there are things associated with being over 85 years old. Self-rated health, functional limitations, and disability, and it gives you some points. And it's targeted to the population, and this really stratifies you into some life expectancy categories pretty easy. Doesn't even require a doctor to do it. This could be done either in the waiting room, even on the phone. And here's if you do this screening test and then do a comprehensive geriatric assessment. Have you guys ever seen or experienced a comprehensive geriatric assessment? They're lovely. They take forever. Or an hour, or hour and a half of time where you get all this detail. So if you take that VES screening tool, which takes a few minutes, and then see who do you learn about things from the comprehensive geriatric assessment? So this is like screening with the VES 13 for a comprehensive geriatric assessment. This is a pretty good ROC curve. It stratifies people pretty well into those who really need the full comprehensive assessment so you can learn what the deficits are. And that's why I would argue some sort of screen and intervention would be much better. This is in the context of cancer screening. So that ROC curve is approaching 0.8 here, which isn't too bad. Also, the VS13 can be used. These are all comers getting chemotherapy for colon cancer. You come in, you're going to get colon cancer treatment. And then afterwards, we look and see what's the best predictor of who lived and who died. That includes anything about the cancer treatment, and about the geriatric assessment. The VES13 for both arms, both the treatment arm and the non-treatment arm, is the best predictor of who will be alive at 2 years. So it does better than any of the cancer markers for who's going to live in both arms. So if you want to know anything, this is probably as valuable as anything about how long people are going to live. So how do we put it all together? You can develop these kinds of screeners across all the domains of a geriatric assessment, which include functional assessments, comorbidities, cognitive screens, geriatric syndromes, nutrition, psychology, and social support. Many people are doing this. We're doing it in our center. It's struggled to get it as short as we can, but you can get this down. We've gotten it down to about 15, maybe 20 minutes to get this information, most of which does not involve time in the doctor's office. Tools that can be done someplace else to get this information and include it into your treatment decisions. And I would argue that that's one better way to get better data. This is the best of the best from geriatric oncology. Arthi Hurria, who's a genius at the City of Hope, did a study, 500 older adults with cancer getting chemotherapy. Did geriatric assessments and then did predictions of toxicity for those patients based on the geriatric assessments, and that's what I want to show you. This is a lot of work, but here's the predictive model. It includes the non-geriatric issues, like what kind of cancer you have, whether you got standard doses of chemotherapy or multiple kinds of chemotherapy, some physiological markers. But then there's age and these other things that are also contributing to the score that I'm going to show you. Okay, it's interesting what's in there, right? So things in there, did you fall in the last 6 months? That's extremely helpful to know. How often are cancer patients asked, did you fall in the last 6 months? Not that often. Hearing impairment is important. Why is that important? I don't know for sure. It's interesting that something like hearing impairment adds to the, is much to the likelihood of having toxicity as, say, getting two kinds of chemotherapy instead of one. Limited ability to walk a block. Here's another favorite one. Decreased social activity. Not getting out to see somebody is also important and adds points. So if you take this and take patients who are getting chemotherapy and add up these points, you get something that looks like this. So here's, what's this test? What's the KPS test? That's the doctor looks at you and goes, you look good, you're a zero, you're gonna do well. And someone else I won't look at, you look like a three, so we don't think you can tolerate chemotherapy. It's their psychological assessment, essentially, of how well the patient's going to do. And then we look at the likelihood of chemotherapy toxicity. And how do they do? Pretty bad. That's a pretty bad way to figure out who's going to get chemotherapy toxicity. Why is that? If you're sitting there, I have no idea what your social circumstances are unless I ask. So my guess may not be that good. Other things like that aren't going to be that good. That's not a good way to do it. Now look at Arthi's scale. Now these are, when I talk about chemotherapy toxicities, this isn't like my fingers tingle a little bit. This is, I had to come back to the hospital at least to get treated for some side effect from having chemotherapy. So these are serious chemotherapy toxicities. So Arthi's scale, if you break it into just these three groups, ranges from 27% for the healthiest group up to 83% for the least healthy category. Now that's good to know. If I was a patient and I was told mortality information and then I was told the likelihood of significant serious chemotherapy toxicity in the next while, I would want to know that. Now that doesn't mean I have to do anything. I'm often the, can you tell this patient they don't need chemotherapy guy in the cancer center? Because the doctor says I don't want to do chemotherapy but I can't find a reason not to. Can you please do that? Like the geriatrician's the one who takes the car keys away, right? So I've been given that job by the family. All the unpleasant things that people don't want to talk about, we get that job. So this is sort of like that a little bit. I don't do that. I tell them I don't do that. I'll tell you what the likelihood is of certain things happening, and then we can have a conversation with the patient about what ought to happen. So here's my schema to sail between Scylla and Charybdis, which is to stratify people into if they're a fit person. The other thing I should point out about chemotherapy for any patient, if you give chemotherapy to patients and they're fit, what's the difference by age of the likelihood of success from chemotherapy? So if you're 80 or you're 50 and you're fit, who benefits the most from chemotherapy? Everybody's the same. Everybody benefits the same if you're fit. If you're fit, you should get offered whatever the main treatment is. That's the point of this. The red box are the people who are in the palliative group. And it's true that we can often say who are the frail people, and they're the ones who probably we should really think hard about what's a palliative approach, because the likelihood that they're going to survive long enough isn't good enough. It's these yellow groups that we have to figure out. They're in the middle. They're a big group of the patients that we're going to take care of. They're the ones who look okay but aren't going to do so well because they don't have social support, their hearing's not so good, things like that. And then there's another group who looks okay, and we screen them, and it turns out they're frail, and we need to not treat them. And geriatric assessment, I've just given you a flavor of it, is the way I would argue we need to assess these things for patients. Okay, now we go to the, so that's overtreatment, undertreatment, maybe treating right in the middle. I'll take a little break. I love Calvin and Hobbes. Now my kids do too, so I get to read it all over again. It's great. This isn't really about older adults, but it's about mistreating patients and communication a little bit. And the punchline here is, you know, is this going to hurt? No. Is this going to hurt? No. Is this going to hurt? You know, it's going to hurt like a cattle prod, and he passes out. and so we need to communicate somewhere in between those two. All right, so I'm going to speed up a little bit here. So here's a study about how we mistreat even when we have the data. I was interested because I thought men who come back with they've been treated for their prostate cancer with surgery or radiation, now they have a rising PSA. So they've come back, their disease has recurred, they were told they were going to be cured, they're not. And they're back in the oncology office, and they're older, they're over 65, and we need to decide whether to start hormone therapy, which has a lot of implications for their health. I went, hung out in the clinic and said, you know why these guys are getting started on hormone therapy? By the way, there's no known survival benefit from starting earlier or later on hormone therapy. So if you start right away or you start later, it doesn't matter. So what do you think it is? They are so freaking nervous. They walk in with a rising PSA and you say, what do you want to do? They want to get treated. They don't want to talk about it. They don't want to hear about the pluses and minuses. They're really nervous. And what do the doctors do? I was curious. Do the doctors talk them out of it? Do they risk stratify them in some way? What do they do? So this was my attempt to figure out how this decision actually gets made. So I asked the oncologists, what do you use to stratify these patients who come in with rising PSAs? How do you make that decision? And this is what they told me. PSA doubling times, time from the primary treatment to PSA increase, PSA level, remaining life expectancy, Gleason grade. most of those are evidence-based. Those are all very reasonable things to say about how they're making the decision. I hope that's what they were doing. Okay? At the bottom of that are things like how much the treatment costs, how anxious the patient is about the cancer. Those are not relevant from their perspective. Okay. All right, so here we ran the studies, brought them in, saw what they actually did, and found out what actually predicted people starting early on hormone therapy among the same doctors who told me why they were treating patients this way. And what's the answer? The answer is how anxious the patient is when they walk in the door. If they're anxious, independent of all those clinical things I just said, they're 7 times more likely or 9 times more likely, if you look at the adjusted model, to start on hormone therapy. Nothing else is close to predicting it. I was stunned. I was stunned this is what actually was happening, right? It doesn't make sense that the patient being this anxious and doctors who know the data and can tell me what the data is still do incredibly non-evidence-based things with a dangerous therapy in an asymptomatic patient. I gave this talk to my oncologists. They're sitting right like you were. It didn't go that great. But they changed what they did after this in a significant way, I think because they believe the data. They didn't believe me saying this, but they believed the data. Here's what actually happens. So what difference does it make? So they start early on hormone therapy. How much longer are they going to be on this therapy that makes them frail? 14 months. 14 months more of therapy that's probably not going to extend your life, causes toxicities, and costs lots of money. Now, this is one example, but I would argue that anxious patients with scary things getting unnecessary expensive treatments happens all the time because of this. And if that's true, the only way we're going to change this is to deal with the emotional issues here, not giving more data. I'm giving them lots of data. The data is not convincing people. Okay, why does it matter? You know, here, I actually wrote a whole paper and published it in Cancer, in which I just wrote out what the toxicities of androgen deprivation was, hormone therapy. And then I wrote out what geriatric frailty was, and they're all the same thing. And so we wrote a paper on that, and it was a surprise at the time to the oncologists how much damage we were doing to patients with hormone therapy that was considered safe. Men have lots of deficits on these therapies, up to 50% or higher on a standard geriatric assessment screen, which we've shown. So that gets you a hint. I have some other data. These things, the emotion story I just told, I think is very relevant. I think it's why we mistreat more than anything else, is that it isn't about data all the time. It's about these other issues of communications and emotions and things like that, and lack of data. In the place of lack of data with system one and system two, so you take out system two, we don't have any data, what do? You revert to system one and we act very emotional. Sometimes even when we have all the data, system one is really hard to overcome. And when's it hardest to overcome? When we don't have much time, when we're under stress, just what we do in a clinical scenario all the time, and we're pushed to do more, to see more patients faster in these systems. And I think we're going to be in trouble trying to change the way we do care if that's the way we think about it, is giving more guidelines, giving more data, and we haven't addressed these other issues. Okay, I know I'm sort of running it out of time. That's why I stop here. The rest of this is about my clinic, so it's a little self-indulgent. But if we want to talk about that part, I thought maybe here we could answer some questions. If you want to know about our clinic, I'll happily talk about it. Let me talk about my son, because he's so happy about this. So here's his sign that he made for me. Here it is, up above the light where I stuck it in clinic. And he came years later and he saw it. He's pointing to it. He's so happy that it's up there where no one can get it down. So that's the SoCare Clinic. And I will, I'll stop there and answer questions, and we can do this if we want to later. Thank you. Thanks.
So thank you. That's a fabulous talk.
Thanks.
I wonder how much, if you're plugged into this new, there's a national demonstration project for Medicare called the Oncology Care Model, which is trying to improve the delivery of chemotherapy to older adults.
Yeah.
And And I'm wondering if USC was picked as a site. We just found out we were picked as a site.
Well, congratulations.
So it's one of those congratulations condolences, right? Looking
at this. It's always the second worst thing is getting the grant, right?
I'm wondering, it seems like everything you said is relevant to how we would approach that project. So I'm wondering what your thoughts are on that, how you're connected to that, or what the opportunities might be.
Yeah, so the last question is easy. I'm happy to talk and help, and I always like to collaborate, time permitting. So my own institution has a kind of a mixed opinion of me, I'd say, in terms of this stuff. I go in front of the oncologist and tell them they're doing it all wrong because they're too emotional and it doesn't go well, things like that. We applied to this. I have no idea if we've gotten ours. I haven't heard from the team. I'm not the primary leader of the cancer model application. I've worked endlessly under a small grant for the foundation to develop a screen, target, intervene, older patients, prevent rehospitalizations. So I've thought a lot about this. I tried to inject a bunch of this into our particular application for it. If we got our grant, then I'll obviously be committed to what we're doing with ours. If we didn't get ours, I'll be even more inclined to find someone else who has one to work with. in any event, I'm happy to share. I just want this information to be wherever it needs to be for patients. So feel free to contact me. Be delighted to help.
So thank you. That's a phenomenal talk. I'm going to give you a case which might be a nice segue into your next segment. My background is as a surgical oncologist, but also a clinical ethicist. And despite wearing both of those hats, these were really hard when you're dealing with individuals. So a man came into my clinic literally this week. He's a frail 80-year-old man with Parkinson's with a fungating painful tumor over his eye that, quite frankly, is going to be very hard to palliate without an aggressive surgery.
It's a skin cancer and melanoma.
Correct, a neglected skin cancer. Which he's neglected because he says, I'm old and frail and I don't want surgery. But of course now it's bothersome enough that he has come in. The dilemma here is I know your work well enough to understand that he will live long enough to reap the consequences of neglecting this tumor, and he already has.
Right.
But the surgical option is a massive operation, which quite frankly I don't know he's up for.
Yeah.
And the model for which to contextualize goals of care in a way in which it's not just a phrase, but in a way that really reflects what he's up against is something that I think all clinicians struggle with. The overtreatment is an easier answer, I feel, than is the potential undertreatment of the frail individual facing a tough problem. And I'm wondering your words of advice and maybe how your clinic can mitigate that.
Yeah, so. Wow, that's an easy one. No. So one thing I want to say about this is, so we're so mortality focused that we lose track, even in prostate cancer, but other examples, there's all kinds of bad stuff that can happen from tumors too. So not treating tumors can be a problem for all kinds of reasons. Like you got to live with that thing for a long time and something bad's going to happen. So I don't think this is an isolated one. I think it's important that we think about that up front. Now, In his case, you know, one's throwaway answer is what, you know, the quality of life for him has got to be the main goal. And I'm not sure he's informed about that enough yet, not knowing anything else about the situation. So I spend a lot of time in two settings, and I'm the wrong person to tell an ethicist how to do this, but, you know, what kind of person are you? Kind of questions, more than like, what are we going to do in this case? I spend a lot of time doing that so that I can figure out, like, are you the kind of person who never wanted to do things? Are you the kind of person who does? Are you the kind of person who, you know, is okay with significant symptoms? Are you the kind of person who really hates a lot of symptoms? Those aren't always the same people who don't want to do things but suffer a lot from them. So finding out a lot of that is worthwhile, I think worth the time invested. After that, I think the second step of that is, what are the real ranges of treatment options in this case? What's genuinely palliative here? So sometimes I think we're in the, like, we do a massive something or other, or we do almost nothing. And there should be lots of stuff in between. and a little bit of geriatrics, which is start low, go slow, do what we can, not try to overdo it in those cases. So those are things I'm sure you've already sort of run through your mind, but I think the at least getting a lay of the land and a little less. Oh, the other part I want to say about this is I think in these difficult ones where it's not clear what to do, too often what we do as doctors is we go, you know, this is a value-based decision. Why don't you tell me what you want to do? And they have no idea because the technical details are not something we can expect them to understand. I think we need to own a little more what we can do realistically and just tell them. And I now tell people, I just tell them, here's the kind of person I am. This is what I would do. Or this is what I would do for my dad. I know I wasn't taught that in med school, but I tell them that up front so they know what my biases are and why I think I'm doing. I think they like that because then they feel like I'm at least on their side of this. So I think the trust issue also counts a lot here. Sometimes I think we try to like, people send patients to me and I'm the guy who has to do all the unpleasant things and I barely know the person. And so what I do in my clinic sometimes is I trust build and then connect what I know to what the others can do or can't do. So you know, I don't know what your relationship, you are the surgeon, so you're in that position. I'm often discussing with the surgeon why I think, you know, I really think we should operate on this guy. What? You just told me never to operate on these old people, right? They got all these problems. He's got all these problems. What do you want to do, right? And I say, no, let's talk about this for a minute. Let's talk about what our goals are, what we really want to do. I think he really wants to be better in this way. So that's a little bit of my clinical gut instinct. I love getting patients like this because then your clinic doesn't have to do so quite as much. You, an ethicist, can do it. My surgical colleagues love it when I send back a, here's how frail they are, I walked them around, here's what they can do. I give them real concrete information. I say, based on this, here's a medical opinion. Now you can make it ethical or a good opinion. So I'd happily see him. He'd have to send me to Chicago, though.
Thank you so much for your presentation.
Thanks.
I had a question with respect to one of the last cases that you were talking about where physicians were ranking the way that they were making their decisions.
Yeah.
And I noticed that one of the variables that was listed at the top was patient preference, which in medical ethics, we typically think of autonomy and respecting someone's autonomy. But
right.
For the bottom was patient anxiety. And I was wondering if how physicians and providers are differentiating or identifying the way in which a patient has preferences. So if they say, well, their preference is really important, but really that preference is dictated by their anxiety, then how are we sorting those variables and
right.
making a decision?
Right. So see, this is why I like coming here to the University of Michigan. Such smart questions. So it took a long time for me to convince oncology what was happening. But you're pretty close to the right answer. So there's a whole part of this talk I give, and it goes like this. So I show this data, and I ask them, just independently, how do you decide with these guys who you want to start early and who you want to start late? And if you, who makes that decision? Do you let them make it? Do you make it? Because the reviews of my grants were like, this doesn't matter that patients are anxious. Doctors make this decision. Patients don't make this decision. That was the kind of feedback I got. And you know what they say? They say, I just let the patient decide. That's what they mean by patient preferences. They got 5 minutes, they laid out the case. Mortality doesn't matter if they start early or late, let them decide. That's patient autonomy, that's what we're doing. And what I said was, are you sure they know what's going on? Are you sure they understand this? I think these are just anxious guys. You haven't even talked to them. You don't know how anxious they are. They're guys, they don't tell you how anxious they are. You know, I mean, they say, I want to be treated. The other answer they give me is, you know what, I can make a patient do whatever I want under the guise of autonomy. That's what they say behind the scenes. I think they should be on it. I shape what I say to them. I make sure what they hear are the reasons they should be on it. Or I can emphasize the toxicities and tell them why they shouldn't be on it. And 90% of the time, they'll choose what I tell them. We've done a little bit, we did a randomized intervention, off-the-shelf intervention, to see if we could change this behavior. So half the men go, they see a videotape, they get all the information on the videotape, then they go see the oncologist, in the other case they don't. And we found we can make them more informed, they are happier with their decision, and they're no less anxious. And it doesn't change their behavior. you have to address anxiety directly. I'm convinced now. It's less about information. It's more about their digestion of the information, their response to it. So I think you're right. I cover up patient preferences, sometimes let people guess, because I think that's the mechanism this is happening by. So I think you're exactly right.
So I appreciated how your model obviously took into account the quality of life years, but I was wondering whether there's a role, if any, for quality of death, because certainly death via the intervention versus death via not intervening from the underlying cause are quite different. And so I was wondering if there was any value or role in considering that.
Absolutely, value, role. I absolutely agree that the quality of the experience of your life from here to the end is what matters fundamentally. For my older patients, I talk a lot about functional independence. If you ask them what quality of life means to them, whether it's the quality of the treatment or the quality of the demise, whatever it is, the two things they want, besides just to live longer, which I understand, is they want to be independent. They don't want to have to depend on people. They want to be in their home. They don't want to be in a facility. They want to be independent. So if I told them, you know, you're going to go through this and you're going to be in a facility for the rest of your life, most of them, I think, would say, forget it. I don't want to do that, my guess. The other thing they want is they, ironically, since independence is so important to them, they want meaningful interaction with other people. They want to be able to do things with their loved ones meaningfully. They have dementia, for example, they're terrified that they're not going to be able to do that anymore. And so however we get to those two things, including the quality of the death, is what I would say is what we should be doing. And that I think mortality is just a, I think we're really doing a bad job of contextualizing what it means to live longer versus live better in all kinds of ways. So I don't know if that completely captures what you want.
So. Great talk. This is a question about maybe a different kind of patient anxiety. You know, a lot of us, doctor clinicians, read Atul Gawande, bestseller, and some folks, and I'll put me in that group, are anxious in the other direction. You're going to do too damn much. You're not going to even take account of what I think, say in my case, life expectancy maybe, or what my preferences really are in terms of quality of life. Do you see that anxiety in these days,
and
they kind of the other direction,
but
I'm not. Right.
It have to do with that. So, by the way, I have to confess, I'm one of the few who feels annoyed reading Gawande's book. So it's been hard for me. I like this other one much better. Here's my reason I get annoyed with it. All the stuff he says is great. He's a wonderful writer. I like Atul Gawande. You know, this is like 20 years ago is when this stuff was relevant. We're way beyond what he says in that book, right? So. I'm worried that then the public we're still that far behind. Oh my God, this is no good. This is a, you know, he's a great surgeon, but couldn't we have a palliative care person write the book? Kind of response. So, but having said all of that, I do see this. Anxiety, the challenge with anxiety is, you know, I presented this with anxiety. I showed you prostate cancer specific anxiety measure. I didn't really talk about it, but it's really the guys who are worried about prostate cancer who are having this strong effect. I have a general anxiety measure, it's in there. It doesn't have the same effect. Our intervention doesn't work as best as I can tell from our qualitative data because we give them this videotape and it's clear they go in, they learn a bunch of stuff, they're much more informed, and then they annoy the hell out of their oncologist. They go in and they go, you didn't tell me I was gonna have this, and you didn't tell me I was gonna be frail, and you didn't tell me I was gonna have hot flashes. What? Tell me about that. And now they're anxious about all the treatments. And so, anxiety is, you know, time dependent, it's target dependent, all that sort of stuff. So I definitely see this. I try to help people recognize what's behind that when they come to me. Like, what are you most worried about? Because we often assume when someone's anxious, we know why they're anxious. And in my experience is that's not at all the case. I say, tell me more about that. I'm terrified. Someone I knew had chemotherapy and it was a disaster. I don't want to have anything to do with that. Okay, great, we're having a completely different conversation now, just because we've learned that. So I see it. I do see people with cancer, especially early on, are so anxious, just getting past the, like, I have cancer and I might die is the first step in the whole thing. I'm sorry, because I'm not sure. Who's next?
So I'm thinking about what you said about this kind of engineered autonomy and steer people to make the choice that we want. And the thing this morning has...
Not me.
Right. That is something that one people generally like own up to do. And the thing this morning has been about sort of being unrealistic about prognosis, overestimating survival, then adding that overestimate for patients.
Yeah.
And I come from a world where people famously overestimate mortality and underestimate quality of life, so to care for it. Right. And what I wonder is if you either have an intuition or evidence about people doing that sort of, you don't want someone to have an intervention, so you kind of like oversell the morbidities of the intervention, you undersell how likely they are to survive it, to kind of steer them towards the lower amount of care that you
right.
Person.
Yeah, this is really hard. So earlier I asked the question about should the oncologist talk to the patient or the palliative care doctor when you're addressing these difficult issues. And part of the reason I'm a little bit inclined towards having the palliative care doctor do it more often is the oncologist at my institution often sell cancer treatment to the patient for a long time to maintain hope, as we heard. Right, they sell it third line, fourth line, they're not ready, especially if they're a little younger, not so much with the older patients, but a little younger patients. And then when they decide they can't do anything anymore, they sell hospice. We're done, you need to be in hospice. They abandon the patient, that's the experience of it, of abandoning the patient. So I guess I would say we shouldn't be in the business of selling the technical stuff to patients to get what we want to happen, but that we should be eliciting from patients the whole time what they really want out of all of their treatment, so that we harmonize from the beginning to the end what really happens to patients. I'd like us to be more explicit and less implicit about steering patients. I don't think it's our business to steer them. Our business is to help them figure out what we can really do for them. It's hard if the patient really is unrealistic and he really wants a miracle and you know it isn't in the cards. But I'm really straightforward with them on that, to be honest. I tell them things like, you know what? I want to do whatever you think you can do. I want you to know, I don't think anything is going to make that happen. I wish I could make your cancer go away by snapping my fingers. I can't do that. I'm not hiding anything. I don't know of any other way to help. But I really think you'll be happiest if we do XYZ. Then I'm not steering them. I'm just telling them, this is what I think you should do in your own light. So that's the best I could see. I don't like this, like, sell what we want to the patient and put it in the guise of our expertise, right?
I don't like it either, but I think people do it.
No, they do it. And I think we need to either teach them how to do it, not do it different, or we should let people who are good at it do it. We do it on our supportive care unit. We just put in a supportive care unit. It's co-managed by oncology and palliative medicine. So two attendings go around, house staff go with us. And we argued that this would be a better way to get both kinds of care to patients. But I can tell you the impact on the oncologists of having someone skilled in this and seeing it, both they are happier to defer the really hard stuff to us. And second of all, they get better at it. They do. They actually see things to say. You don't say, I mean, I give farcical examples. They'll say, you know what, for someone with prostate cancer, you're going to die of something else anyway, essentially. So why should we worry about this? And, I mean, they don't quite say that, but pretty darn close. When what they could say is, you know what, on the list of things for you, your prostate cancer is like number 4 or 5 probably on what's going to cause problems or have you die sooner. Your cardiovascular disease, your other, your pulmonary conditions, those are much more important to me. If we get to the point where I can treat that so that prostate cancer is a problem, I'll be delighted. And the patients get it. It's a prioritization. They're not stupid, they're smart. So they can grasp it, but not when you sort of overwhelm them emotionally with things that are just not helpful. So I can't tell if I've helped, but those are sort of some thoughts.
Thank you for pointing that important research. I also want to thank CBSSM and Bishop Payne for bringing this enlightening discussion this morning. I had a question, and I guess it's more of a clinical or practical question. So when I'm in clinic, I'm a radiation oncologist. So when I'm in clinic with my 89-year-old who is already receiving hormonal therapy, is still functionally independent. And he's trying to decide if he should receive radiation or not. You know, there are a lot of sources of information that we can rely on. You know, we look at prostate mammogram to determine the risk of this cancer. We can estimate many life expectancy. And I wanted to hear from you your suggestion on practical ways of doing an abbreviated geriatric assessment. And I don't know if you're suggesting that you use the vulnerable elder survey that you have, or just your thoughts on how to help us when we're shooting from the hip and kind of difficult in certain situations.
Yeah, they're great. The best sort of boiled down examples I can give are, I do like the vulnerable elder survey if you can't do it in clinic or you need to do it sort of, it's gonna disrupt clinic flow. They're straightforward questions. They're basically survey questions. They really do stratify people into those who are most vulnerable. I like it a lot. There's another one called the G8 test, which is more popular in Europe, which does a similar set of thing and it is arguably a little better than the VES13. So I'm happy to send those to you. Another one is when you ask people survey questions, the problem with asking people if they're functional at home is they lie. You know, they lie in understandable ways, like I can do this, right? But we've all had that experience. They say, yes, I can do whatever, right? And the daughter or the spouse or somebody's in the background going, you know, they can do it because they're dragging them to the bathroom, right? So we do some simple assessments in clinic to get actual, we do gait speed testing. I do something called the short physical performance battery. It takes about 5 or 10 minutes. There's a videotape I could send you. It's a balance test, a short gait speed test, and a time chair stand test. And it gives you a number between 0 and 12, and it's easily stratified. And all you need is a clinic, a chair, and a stopwatch, essentially, and a little bit of information, you can do it. And it gets away from the like asking questions. It actually tests them right then and there, and you can go with information. The third one I have to say is you have to think hard about what you want to do about cognitive issues. You know, radiation oncology, we do whole brain radiation on patients who are already getting demented and bad stuff happens. And we don't screen. We can send people for chemotherapy who nod nicely but have no idea what you're talking about and they sign the consent form. So I recommend some short screeners, at least a, you know, mini cog is the minimum. It takes like 2 minutes. You could do a couple others I'm happy to show you. So those three things are what I'd say. A survey question, a in-house, and maybe a cognitive screen.
Okay, last question here in front.
Could you comment on what you think the role of physician population is in these treatment outcomes that you describe, their own sadness, anxiety, uncertainty, those kinds of things. How do you see that, whether and how you see that playing a role, and what do you think might address that effectively?
I think about this a lot. I think that it's a hugely important contributor to how care gets delivered. There's lots of evidence that doctors are no different than anybody else for people too, and that our emotions play out in doctors as well as they do in others. We have a series of studies, I'll indulge in this, on aneurysms. So you have an aneurysm and it's growing and it might burst. And there's a very specific guideline that when it gets to a certain size, you do the operation because the risk of death from the operation no longer exceeds the risk of the aneurysm bursting. So we built a computer program that mimics this, took it to a vascular surgery conference, gave them all the statistics, and then we did one randomization, which we said, we just want to show you how this simulation works. And in one group, the simulation bursts early. The aneurysm bursts early when it shouldn't have statistically. And in the other one, it sort of plays out, just to see if that prior case then impacts what they're going to do later. Right? So if you can imagine what we did. And I thought, oh, come on, these vascular surgeons, they know the data. I'm showing them the data as we do it. It's literally on the screen. Here's the size of the aneurysm. Here's the risk of things happening. And it's overwhelmingly strong that if they see that bursting aneurysm, they operate early the next time. The odds ratio is almost 2-3 in some studies. And the vascular surgeons are worse than the geriatricians. We went to the geriatrics conference. And the only ones who are close to the data are the anesthesiologists. And my best guess is you're really invested in this whole thing. You're a surgeon, this is what you do, you take care of patients. The error of omission is really, really hard. So I think that, so it's just an example of, I think these are extremely strong effects. They have to be figured out. What else? It's fascinating. They're worse than the patients. The vascular surgeons are worse than the patients on this little experiment I just described. So I have an email I show from my vascular surgery colleague. She says to me, I know the data, I've done the study, I know what you're gonna tell me. Patient came in last night, her aneurysm was this size, it's too small. I told her she'll go home in the morning. I went to bed, her aneurysm burst and she died in the hospital last night. I feel horrible and I'm gonna operate early the next time. She says, and I know I shouldn't.
You're,
I mean,
the case of a patient dying from surgery?
So, brilliant idea. So we did do that. We had a third arm in which we did the early surgery burst as part of the randomization. Doesn't matter. So they're willing to accept the cost of doing surgery as part of the cost of doing surgery. That's part of their mindset. The last thing I'll say on this, for this group especially, what's super interesting about this is in most of our lives, the errors of commission we hate. Right, the one where something happens outside the window and we all want to turn our eyes because we don't want to get involved in that argument or that problem or that whatever, because you'll probably be punished later for it. In the surgery case, it's the opposite. It's the error of omission that drives them crazy because they are trained to do this and that's what they do, and they can't live with the fact that I didn't do something I could have, even though the evidence and data tells them it's the wrong thing to do. Absolutely think it's the same effect. I absolutely think I've seen them save people, right? Sometimes they save people. And when you see a save, like, how are you not gonna try to offer that to people? I get it.
We have plenty more time for discussion.
Thanks.
Lunch, but I wanna have us thank Dr. Dale again one more time.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you.